you're lost.
No, I'm not lost. Let's see if anyone in here can help us. Hello?
Who are all these people?
Hello, everyone. Welcome to Rhythm and Rose. I'm your host, Joshua Jacob. We have a very special guest. We have Robby Henson, director and screenwriter of the movie House. This is a Halloween special because this movie is really incredible. Awesome movie directed by this gentleman right here. So thank you, sir, for being on Rhythm and Rose.
Well, Josh, I appreciate you putting me on here. And
yes, sir.
A movie we did, that was over 10 years ago, but hopefully it's been around a little bit.
It's been a while, right? Yes, sir. Yeah. So tell me, like, how did you come across this project? Like, how did you get in touch with Ted Dekker, or how did they come to you? Like, well, how did it all start?
Well, it started, I was living in Los Angeles at the time, and I had just finished a film with Billy Bob Thornton called The Badge, which is a Southern crime thriller drama.
Oh, wow. Okay.
And I had done that, and I got a call from Joe Goodman, who is a faith-based producer out of Louisville, Kentucky.
Okay.
You'll notice I pronounce Louisville correctly because I'm from Kentucky.
Oh,
so
nice.
He called
okay.
me up in LA and said, hey, you know, I'm doing some Ted Dekker projects and Frank Peretti projects, and he wanted to pull me into that. So the producer, Joe Goodman has been around for a while. He actually kind of started with a film called Hangman's Curse. And then he actually
actually remember that one. Yes.
Yeah. The Left Behind series. Joe Goodman was, one of the producers.
Wow. He did that too? Hangman. Wow. The Left Behind.
Yeah. And I'm a little jelly about what he's doing now. I don't know if you know what Joe is doing now.
I'm not familiar what he's doing now. What he's doing now.
He just knocked it out of the park with a movie that's going to be released with Ethan Hawke directing.
Whoa, is that right?
Flannery O'Connor's story, because Flannery O'Connor, was a very Catholic writer. And
okay.
Ethan Hawke's daughter, Maya, is starring in it.
Oh, wow.
And Ethan Hawke directed, and Liam Neeson plays a priest. And
oh, he's in there too? Oh,
yeah.
No way. And, oh, man.
Laura Linney, is in there. And Joe didn't call me up and get me to come in on that one, but good for Joe, man. He kind of.
Yeah, good for him, man. Wow. Yeah.
Awesome. And then that is the Flannery O'Connor movie that's premiered at Toronto Film Festival. And
okay.
I assume it'll be out this coming year, in 2024 pretty soon. So, but anyway, to answer your story, Josh, Joe Goodman, that producer, had the rights to some Frank Peretti and Ted Dekker thrillers. And Joe always had the belief that he could make faith-based horror films that would cross demographic, that would perhaps pull in the horror fan and then also pull in the faith-based fan.
Okay.
And I think, that worked out somewhat. If they had hit a home run with ticket sales, that would have really proved that theory. But Joe was a big advocate of that theory.
Interesting. Okay. I did not know about that. So thank you for sharing that. Wow. Okay. So he reached out to you and then you just said, yeah, I'll definitely jump on and start.
Yeah. And then the first was a Frank Peretti based book called The Visitation.
I do remember that, man.
With Edward Furlong.
Yes. And
I think that was in 2004, 2005.
Yes.
And we shot that, I remember, in Visalia, California. And we had Randy Travis in that. Mm-hmm. And Edward Furlong, which was an actor I always respected because he was the kid in the first Terminator movie, right?
Right, you know, right.
Little kid in Terminator.
Yeah.
So that was Edward Furlong. And then he was in American History X. And we pulled him into The Visitation. And we actually had some really good actors in The Visitation. Wow. Based on a Frank Peretti novel. Mm-hmm. So I worked with Joe Goodman on three of these films in quick succession.
Okay.
We had Joe was able to get output deals with Fox Studios, and so it was the home video division.
Okay.
But I was like, we're working, man. You know, it's like, hey, let's do these three films in fast succession. And that was Visitation.
Yes.
Three. And the last one was House.
Wow. Yeah. Amazing. That is incredible. You did three plus Visitation as well?
Yeah, I think within 3 years, we did them all, you know, it's like one a year. It's like,
that boom, is crazy. You know,
2005, 2006, 2007.
Seven. Back to back. That's incredible.
Yeah.
Go ahead. Yep.
One of the fun things was, I had a friend of mine who was working with Rob Zombie, and his name was Lou Temple. So we were doing these, you know, faith-based horror films, but we were able to bring in some Rob Zombie actors like Bill Moseley, like Leslie Easterbrook, and then my friend Lou Temple, who'd been in Rob Zombie movies. So that was kind of a cool thing. And, you know, that was a cool thing.
Nice. So did you actually get to meet Frank Peretti and Ted Dekker during the process of House?
I did not meet.
Okay.
Ted Dekker, you know, liked to get on a plane and fly around wherever we were doing his movies. So, I got to hang out in Poland with Ted Dekker.
Oh, nice.
A lot of pierogies and blintzes in Poland. Yeah.
Oh, that's awesome. I bet he was a great experience just meeting him and getting to know him.
Yeah. He's very prolific and, you know, was always interested in telling stories. So, yeah, that was good.
Awesome. I used to work back in 2006. I used to work for Family Christian Stores. Remember that back in the day?
I remember the title of those.
Yeah. So that was a company where it was a Christian bookstore that sold films and music and books, Bibles and all that. And one of the films that they sold was definitely Three and House. Yeah. Okay. And of course, they sold Ted Dekker's books as well and Frank Peretti's. So I was very intrigued by Ted Dekker's work and Frank Peretti's. And one of the bestsellers there was House. And I remember when this book came out, it was one of the top sellers. And I was like, I read the book back in 2007. And I was like, this book is incredible. Just the dynamic behind this and the story. And then when the film came out, I watched it. And I was like, wow, this for a faith-based film? I mean, you did a great job in creating a horror.
Yeah, you know, I'm just randomly, you know, because this was over 10 years ago, but I think we got a raw deal from the ratings board, you know, because the movie was rated R.
Mm, okay.
And why? You know, it's
yeah, you why? Know, yeah, that's true.
It had no cursing. It had no risque, you know, situations between, you know, anyone.
Mm-hmm.
They said the violence was just, you know, was very graphic. And I don't even think the violence was very graphic.
No, so, I don't think so either. No.
You know, and I could not believe, you know, because you see a lot of like Pirates of the Caribbean where they put swords through people and that'll get a PG-13.
Oh, yeah. I mean.
Yeah. But I think they did kind of hold it against being faith-based that they wanted to stick us with the R on House.
Oh,
and that
I
was
see.
A mystery to me to this
wow.
day.
Okay. And so when you did the film House, like what was the process of finding the location? I actually noticed because I rewatched it yesterday on Amazon Prime. Just to catch up. I didn't notice there was two songs in there from the band Amberlin. And I don't know if you're familiar with it. I'm a huge fan of Amberlin. I was like,
I did not notice that.
So that's cool. Did you pick those songs?
I did not. Actually, you know, in the, is there a German word, Strum und Drang, which means the drama of filmmaking. I was not in the final edit of the edit room of House. I was for three. Oh, okay. And I was for The Visitation, but they decided to go a different direction with the editing. And it would have been your favorite band would have been picked by, you know, the producers and the editors.
Okay.
So I'm
interesting. Okay. No, that's fine. It's just, I remember in the beginning of the film, they played their song. Towards the end, it definitely was there. And I was like, wow, I wonder if Robby just had the option to pick them, like Amberlin, because I guess at that time in 2009 when the movie came out, that's when these songs came out. So it must have been, interesting. Okay. So the actor that you hired, which was the, the one that was in the Al Pacino film.
Michael Madsen?
Is it Michael Madsen, the main one who plays the cop in the film?
Michael Madsen plays the kind of the demonic character.
Who played the cop. Yeah. And how did you get a hold of, what made you want to choose him to play the character in this?
Well, he's been in a lot of Tarantino movies, you know, Reservoir Dogs and other things.
Yes, right, right.
You know, we were sometimes in the casting when you're going through the Hollywood casting process, you really, you know, have like 20 names on a list and then you're just trying to see who you can get. And maybe I'm just being honest. Maybe you don't get your first or your second. Maybe you're down to your third or fourth. But I always liked Michael Madsen, you know, because, you know, mainly from the Reservoir Dog days. And just I think he actually has a pretty cool part in Kill Bill.
Yes, actually does. Yeah, I remember that. Yeah, he does.
So for a demonic presence, you know, we thought he would be really good. And you know, so I was really, he was the biggest, you know, name in the film. In regard to House. And then he, you know, we got him on a plane and we flew him to Poland.
Oh,
and
wow.
Unfortunately, okay. The airline lost all of his bags.
God. Are you serious?
And I'm just, you know, I'm gossiping a little, but I remember he was not a happy camper the first week.
Wow.
Being on the set in Poland because he didn't have any underwear.
Luggage, yeah. No luggage or anything.
Or toothbrush.
Oh, my God.
So, and, you know, his part was a little bit bigger. But I think there was something in his life that was making him lose focus a little bit. So some of the things he was doing lacked a little bit of focus and his part was cut down a little bit. But still, you know, when he came after we shot the film and he had to come back to do some, you know, ADR, which is, you know, putting voice work in after the film is already shot. Right. He had a much better attitude. I think he was just freaked out to go to a foreign country and work in that. Wow. He did have a little bit of a lack of focus, in my opinion.
Really?
Yeah.
So being a director, how was your, the time with him? Did you feel kind of like you had to really just work with him in a way of patience and all that because of what he went through?
Yeah, you had to work with him in a way of patience. And, you know, sometimes it was like managing, you know, his moods a little bit.
Wow.
And, you know, it was a little bit of that. But you know, he's a movie star, you know, or somewhat of a movie star, and you know, really delivers the goods as far as having a real charisma and persona. So we were really happy to have him in the film.
Yeah, no, that's awesome. And I know he was also in the film Donnie Brasco.
Oh yeah,
remember that one? Yeah, he was.
I do remember that one. That was a little bit of a quirky art film. Yeah,
yes, very good film, which starred him as well. He was in there. That's awesome. I'm shocked that you got him in there. That's what I was intrigued. I was like, I wonder the story behind how you got that actor in there.
Yeah, you know, sometimes there's stories. This one was more or less, you know, you call the manager and you make an offer and they have 7 days to say yes or no.
Right, right.
So it was more or less like that. Yeah.
Just curious, did you have a plan B if it didn't work out with this actor?
You know, I'm sure we did. You know what, you have 20 names on the list, you know, for a part like that.
Yeah.
And also that was a film that, you know, some of the younger actors were up and coming and didn't have, you know, as many movies as he did. So he definitely was the biggest name on the set, you know.
Right, for instance, right, of course. Yeah.
For instance, you know, we wanted to help publicize the Polish film industry. So Michael Madsen gets off the plane in Poland, and the producers had scheduled him to go right into a press conference to basically say, it's so great to be here in Poland. The guy had just lost all his baggage on the flight, and
that is insane. Didn't want
any part of it. So,
yeah, just forget that part. Just make sure you're glad to be here.
So we had to go kind of into the star management of
God. Yeah. And how did you come across with the rest of the actors in there, the actors and actresses? How did you find them?
Well, Bill Moseley probably is another name in that. And he played, like, there's a creepy a trio of creepy characters living in the house, Leslie Easterbrook and Bill Moseley and Lou Temple. And do you remember they're kind of, you know, Bill Moseley has got, you know, kind of using using an axe in a meat locker and stuff. And,
oh, right, right. Yeah.
As I said, those guys I knew from actually Bill was in the movie 3 playing the alter ego of the main character. Okay. So I just worked with Bill in Poland like 6 or 7 months before.
Oh, nice. Okay.
And Lou Temple, likewise, I had worked with Lou Temple in Visitation, and those guys were the Rob Zombie actors. So
okay.
Leslie, Bill, and Lou, you know, we kind of just pulled in from the Rob Zombie camp.
Wow, interesting. That's awesome. So when I watched this film last night, just again, because I mean, the last time I saw it before yesterday was actually when it was released. And I saw this film yesterday, just again, just to catch up. It did give me a feel of that movie. I don't know if you ever seen it, by 1408 by Stephen King.
No.
So because I know in this film with the house, it had that story behind the daughter that was killed ice skating and all. Yeah. So 1408 had a bit of feel of that, where not she died. She didn't die that way, but the family, the parents lost their daughter, and then they're reminiscing on that. And it's like something that's always haunting them. So when I saw this again, I was like, wow, that actually reminded me a little bit of 1408, which is actually a really good movie from Stephen King. But
I thought we found a really good young lady to play that kind of ghostly presence of the girl.
Right, right.
You know, be inside the house and locked inside the house in some way. And I will say I kind of had arguments with Ted Dekker, because I kind of felt he should pick one thing that the house was doing. He kind of, in the book, in my opinion, and yes, Ted sold so many more books than I did, but in my opinion, you had this evil cop, Michael Madsen.
Right. Right.
You had the evil family of three weirdos. Right. And then you have this kind of ghost girl that comes in late into the movie. And I kind of thought he should pick one. It's okay. Like, is this going to be a movie about the ghost girl? Is this going to be a movie about the bad cop?
Right.
You know, is this going to be a movie about the three creepy people who, you know, chop people up in the meat locker in the house?
Yeah, right, right.
But I think Ted saw it as, you know, the house was really malignant, and it had lots of things that it was doing. So maybe there's no right or wrong in that argument, but I felt like if you focus, you know, I teach screenwriting now, you know, more so than make movies, and I'm always like, keep it simple.
Oh, you do? Okay. Awesome.
Yeah. Focus on the one villain, you know, kind of thing. Yes.
Right. So to my understanding, like you mentioned, the female young girl that played the light in that film, which she was the one that stuck there, was she representing like Christ, or was she representing the faith of, because I know your main actor that played the cop, the main villain.
Yeah.
Michael, right? Or
yes, Michael.
Madsen, yeah, Michael. Yeah. So he was portraying as evil. But then when she came in later on as light, she said, he told her, you're not welcome here. And all of a sudden that light moved him into, you know, into a different aspect. So was that the direction?
I think you're reading as much as I would say that I knew, you know, we saw her as a light to, you know, Pierce and in combat, you know, the evil of Michael Madsen's character.
Right, right.
Okay. But I felt like she kind of arrived on the scene a little late in the movie. So in my personal opinion, you know.
No, yeah. I mean, I have to see that. I was kind of like, oh, who, where did she come from? What's the story behind her? But it was interesting, the fact that her light did portray as in like it's going to get rid of darkness, if that's what Ted Dekker and them, Frank Peretti, portrayed for the book.
Yeah. You know, I'm just gossiping about scenes. I remember the scene where she was doing her one of her final battles with Michael Madsen. And I'm talking about this 12-year-old girl, you know, yes, fighting Michael Madsen. Right. And it ended with Michael Madsen kind of getting burned into the walls of the
right,
house.
Right, right, right.
And so I was like, okay, Michael, you've got a shotgun. And when you, I want you to thrust it at her, but do not hit her. And he, you know, he was so unfocused. He was like, you want me to hit this beautiful 12-year-old girl with a shotgun? Like, no.
Oh, my God. Really?
Not to hit her. You know,
right. Like, yeah.
You want me to hit this beautiful 12-year-old girl? So we were kind of having a miscommunication, you know, along those lines. About
that. Towards that part, right? Where he gets, yeah. Where he gets. Yeah. Okay.
Where he's not understanding, you know, at all what I was sort of coming from. So.
Right. And just interesting, where did you find the house at? Like, where, like, how did your scouts find this house, this particular house for the film?
You know, we shot this in Poland, and I mentioned the producer, Joe Goodman, who's now, you know, working with Ethan Hawke on the Flannery O'Connor movie. Joe always has these ideas that I could say are crazy, or you could say they are really ambitious ideas. And one was he wanted to shoot movies in Poland because he really respected the Polish cinematographers and the Polish art directors.
Wow,
and he thought he could get a certain look for a film going over there for that. And I think he did. You know, these movies, the budgets for these movies are about $2 million.
Okay.
And, you know, I think we got some pretty good looks for them.
You did.
That was what Joe wanted, was to shoot in Poland, where there was, you know, everybody goes to art school who's in the art department in filmmaking in Poland.
Wow.
And we found this town called Łódź. That's the pronunciation in Poland. It's spelled L-O-D-Z.
Okay.
You know, it's like the third or fourth biggest city in Poland.
Wow.
And it had a lot of old, you know, rich people's dachas or homes out in the country, and that's where we found the house.
Is that where you found the house? Oh, wow.
Yeah,
okay.
It probably was a Jewish family that had owned it back in the day, and then Nazi Germany came along.
Wow.
And
okay.
You know, the Jewish owners lost ownership of that house, but it was a very creepy house, you know.
Oh, I bet. I mean, just the inside of what you guys shot, I was like, dang, is this like I mean, that's the thing of your trailer. It portrayed a little bit like it was a haunted house from your trailers. This film, it would portray it as that. Yeah, and I like that you guys did that. So I'm very big on films like that.
Yeah.
So pretty good job on that. So, sir, back to you. I want to know, just how did you get started in filmmaking? Like, where did you go to school for that? Or what was your first film? And if you don't mind.
You know, I am from Kentucky, and that's where I am right now in this moment. I am artistic director of Pioneer Playhouse, which is a summer stock theater in Danville, Kentucky.
Oh, wow.
And
okay.
Started by my father. So, you know, I did 16 years in New York City in the film business. I did 16 years in the film business, but I returned back to Kentucky, and I'm teaching in prison, and I'm teaching at the University of Kentucky. I'm writing novels, I'm not making films as much as I did 10 years ago. So, the way that I got into filmmaking was my father ran a theater, you know, with actors. And so I was always interested in that.
Wow.
I went off to undergraduate as an English major. And I decided to go to film school at NYU in New York.
Oh, you did? Oh, wow. Yeah. Okay, awesome.
Yeah, Spike Lee was, you know, in my class. And
My God. Spike Lee was in your class?
Yeah, yeah.
Awesome. That's awesome. Yeah.
He used to work in the equipment room, you know, like, you know, giving out equipment to the students. And he would always give the rich kids bad cameras.
Oh, my God. That's crazy. Bad cameras.
Yeah.
Wow.
So, you know, because he wanted to kind of stick it, you know, to the man.
Right.
So, yeah.
Okay.
But anyway, then once I got out of NYU, I went into documentary filmmaking for about 10 years or so. And then I made a feature film when I lived in New York called Pharaoh's Army with Chris Christopherson and Chris Cooper.
Wow.
And it got into a number of film festivals and got picked up by Lionsgate.
Oh, wow. It did?
Yeah. So that, you know, the thing is if you can make an independent film and it gets picked up by Lionsgate, you know, there's going to be some doors that open up to you.
Oh, of course. So yeah. That's awesome.
Doors in LA opened up a little bit, and I went out there and did some writing for, you know, big directors, and made my film The Badge with Billy Bob Thornton. And then I ran into Joe Goodman, but it kind of all started, you know, going through NYU, you know, 10 years later, making my first independent feature film. You know?
That's awesome that I get picked up from Lionsgate. That's awesome.
Yeah.
So are you working on anything right now? Is there anything?
Well, I'm back, you know, it's about coming home for me, and I'm back home where it all started here in Kentucky, but I've gone into novel writing. And if anybody out there, Loud Water by Robby Henson, you know, this is published by Down and Out Books, which is a thriller. It is a story of redemption. It's about a guy who gets out of prison and he wants to be a painter and an artist, but sins of the past are kind of always pulling him in. So
Can you purchase that on Amazon?
Amazon, Barnes and Noble.
Anywhere. Awesome.
You can order at Amazon, Barnes and Noble, or any place that sells books. So yeah, it's getting good reviews. So I'd never written a novel before, so I'm trying.
It's your first. Okay.
Yeah, I'm kind of doing the Ted Dekker thing, you know.
Nice. So, what inspired you to want to write a book?
Well, Josh, you know, it actually was based on a story from a screenplay that I loved and never got made. So,
is that right? Okay, so it's pertaining to that.
So the outline, creatively, the screenplay really kind of had an outline that I always believed in. And, writing 70,000 words, you know, is still a task.
Right.
I wasn't sure.
I can imagine.
But I think I'm very pleased with how it turned out.
I'm glad, sir. I'm glad. And how long ago since you released it?
It was only pretty recent. It was like September 1st that it was released, you know.
Oh wow, just recently. Okay. Congratulations on that. Awesome. Okay. Yeah. I like to order a book and read it. Yeah, because
Check it out. Now it is pretty gritty. You know, it has a little bit.
I do not mind that.
Yeah.
I do not mind that. That's awesome.
A little bit of prison cursing goes on.
Okay. Is there a way I can order it directly from you where you can sign it for me?
Oh, yeah. Actually, I'll send you the link. A local bookstore in my town handles the signing and shipping, you know.
Oh, so sweet. Okay. Yeah. Feel free to send me that message and I'll go ahead and purchase it from you. Awesome. Well, thank you again for coming. Thank you for coming on the podcast, and I really appreciate your time. Do you plan on doing any films in the future of anything of yours in the working?
Well, I always hope that I can, but Josh, you're younger than me, and I think filmmaking is a little bit of a younger man's profession, and it may be that I'm writing novels, and I did mention I do teach theater and performance art in the prison system. Here in Kentucky. So I'm kind of doing some other things, and I teach students at the University of Kentucky.
Oh, awesome. Okay.
Yeah. Now filmmaking is such an expensive canvas, you know, even with your digital camera, you still rack up some expense on it. So,
yes. My brother actually went to school in La Mirada, Biola University. He went to cinema and film. So he actually has done some short films. So I cannot imagine.
Did you say that was Loyola University?
Biola University in La Mirada, California. Yeah, Biola. Yeah, he actually went to school there for cinema and film. So my brother's actually doing some films, some shorts here and there. It's doing pretty well. So that's why I'm very intrigued by your film with the house. My brother's aware of it. I told him I'm going to have Robby Henson come on and do this. So he's really like, wow, that's awesome. Because, I mean, it's been around since I was young. So.
Yeah.
A film.
Well, so. Good. Well, Josh, great talking to you. I think you have a great spirit about you. I see you got is that an Ovation guitar or some other kind of guitar there?
Yeah, it's actually my father's guitar. I'm actually a drummer. So the podcast is called Rhythm and Roads because I'm a musician. So rhythm of life, of what God has blessed me with, just the experience of music. But then we all have a road in life of our journey. So we have a story to share that we inspire others to. Of every aspect of life. So that's why I got put into my heart to bring as much people I can onto the podcast and share their story to inspire others, because I mean, we're all in our own journey. So this is your story, sir. And I'm glad you were able to come on.
Yeah, well, it sounds beautiful. Josh, I'm so happy to be here, and you have a wonderful rest of your Sunday evening.
Well, thank you, sir. Thank you. And I do want to purchase a book directly from you, and you can sign it for me.
I'll send you the email. Yeah.
Please
but,
do.
Loudwater, Robby Henson, Amazon, Barnes Noble for anybody else out there. But with you, I'll give you the special place you can order a signed book.
Please do. Email it to me, sir. I definitely will purchase that directly from you. All right, everyone. Well, thank you for watching Rhythm and Roads. I'm your host, Joshua Jacob. We have Robby Henson, director and screenwriter of the movie House. Amazing film. Great for around this time, too, for Halloween. It's just this film is incredible. Great horror, faith-based film directed by Mr. Robby Henson himself. So thank you, sir, for coming on your time.
Thank you. All right, everybody. Good night.
Good night, and we'll catch you on the next episode.